earlier lessons on indefinite integration, we discussed method of substitution and six special integrals with their various applications. Today, we will discuss a special technique of integration which uses partial fractions. It is a method which is used to integrate rational functions, functions which are in the form f(x) by g(x), where f(x) and g(x) are both polynomials. Now, the process that is known as resolving into partial fractions or breaking into the partial fractions is a process which is quite opposite to the one which you had learned in algebra of combining two rational expressions as one expression with a common denominator. For example, consider this. You are all very familiar with the idea of how to combine 2 by x plus 1 plus 3 by x minus 3 and write it as 5x minus 3 by xk minus 2x minus 3. It's done very simply by taking the LCM and combining the numerator as it turns out to be. Now, what we are interested in today is to learn first how to go in the opposite direction. Given 5x minus 3 by xk minus 2x minus 3, how do we go back into these two simple fractions? Now, you can see here how we are going to use them. If I have to integrate this function, then right now we don't have any such technique to handle it. But if I can break it as this plus this, then the integral of both these functions is a very simple task. Now, how do we go back? Well, it's not a very difficult task. If you can see that I can always write 5x minus 3 by x square minus 2x minus 3 as a by x plus 1 plus b by x minus 3, where x plus 1 and x minus 3 are the linear factors of the given polynomial in the denominator. And therefore, I can say from here that 5x minus 3 by x square minus 2x minus 3 is equal to a times x minus 3 plus b times x plus 1 upon x plus 1 into x minus 3. That is, again, use your knowledge of algebra and combine now the right hand side. And now, since these two expressions have the same denominator, the numerator should be equal. And therefore, 5x minus 3 should be equal to a times x minus 3 plus b times x plus 1. A condition which is true for all the values of x. And that's the key here. What we are interested in is finding exact values of a and b such that the breakup that we had established earlier holds. Now, if you look at this expression, to find the values of a and b, there are several ways out. One very simple way out is to equate the like terms, but that again gets complicated as we move on and we bring in quadratic or maybe cubic functions. So, what we can do as an alternative is again another simple choice. Take certain values of x such that either this part gets 0 or the coefficient of a gets 0. For example, if I take the value of x as 3, then x minus 3 is going to vanish and therefore we are left with 15 minus 3, that is 12, is equal to b into 3 plus 1, which is 4b, giving you b as 3, exactly the number which we had here to start the example with. The b upon x minus 3 was exactly 3 by x minus 3. Similarly, if you take value of x as say minus 1, you will be able to show that a comes out to be equal to 2. So, you see, it's not a very tedious task as it will turn out to be. But two things have to be kept in mind while using the method of partial fractions. One, the degree of f(x), that is, if we are considering a rational function of the type f(x) by g(x), then the degree of the denominator has to be greater than that of the numerator. So, degree fx in other words should always be less than degree gx. And if it is not so in the given problem, you first must divide and write it as a proper fraction. And the second thing that you will and you will have to keep in mind will be to break the denominator of that proper rational function into either linear factors, which may again turn out to be linear but non-repeated. Do you understand that? Linear non-repeated means something like a breakup x minus 2 into x plus 1, or it can also turn out to be linear repeated. You have breakup of a particular expression turning up as x minus 2 whole square into x plus 1. They are all linear factors, but x minus 2 is a repeated factor. And there could be another possibility of linear and a quadratic factor, or linear and a repeated quadratic factor. The list of course is extended to other degrees also, but we will try to stick to this level at least for the time being. Let us take a look at the corresponding partial fractions that we have for each of the corresponding factor in the denominator. To start with, we have here, take a good look. If the factor in the denominator is x minus a, the corresponding partial fraction is a by x minus a, as just shown in that example. Corresponding to x minus a whole square, that is, if you may end up with x minus 2 whole square in the denominator or x plus 1 whole square in the denominator, the breakup, that is the corresponding partial fractions, turns out to be a by x minus a plus b by x minus a whole square. Simply for a reason that when you again take the LCM here, you will have x minus a whole square. For similarly extending the idea, x minus a whole cube, the corresponding partial fractions will be a by x minus a plus b by x minus a whole square plus c by x minus a whole cube. Corresponding to ax square plus bx plus c, you have to be careful, the corresponding partial fraction turns out to be ax plus b by the quadratic. And our task will be to find these suitable a, b and c such that the breakup is balanced on both the sides. And let us now consider one of these problems so that the idea becomes absolutely clear to you as to how this breakup, which we are calling as resolution into the partial fractions or the method of integration using partial fraction, makes our task very easy. To start with, let us consider the first type, the type where the denominator factorizes into linear but non-repeated factors. Consider integral of 3x plus 2 by 2x square plus x minus 3. So, as it was said, the first thing that you must try to do is to factorize the denominator, and you can see very well that 3x plus 2 by 2x square plus x minus 3 can be written as 3x plus 2 by 2x plus 3 into x minus 1, the corresponding factors here. Another thing I would like to mention at this stage is the partial fractions process, that is to break up the fraction into sum of other simple fractions. That process is independent of what we are going to do as a final step in involving integration. So, do not involve the integral sign and dx at this stage. Consider the polynomial separately and break it up into the partial fraction and then finally bring in your integral, and you will find your task becoming much simpler and quicker. So, coming back to your work, as said, corresponding to 2x plus 3, the partial fraction is a by 2x plus 3. Corresponding to x minus 1, the partial fraction can be written as b by x minus 1. And so, what we can do is again equate the numerators on both the sides once LCM is taken on right hand side. Right hand side on taking LCM looks like ax minus 1 plus b into 2x plus 3 by 2x plus 3 into x minus 1. So, equating the numerators on both the sides, we get 3x plus 2 is equal to a times x minus 1 plus b times 2x plus 3. And so, again use the idea as I suggested earlier, take the value of x such that either the coefficient of a here or the coefficient of b becomes 0. So, to start with, what will we take as the value of x? Most conveniently 1. So, x is equal to 1 if you take, we will have 5 is equal to b into again 5, leading to your value of b as 1. Similarly, choose the value of x such that the coefficient of b here becomes 0, and that is very conveniently again minus 3 by 2. And if you take x as minus 3 by 2, you can see your a again will come out to be 1. Again, a calculation which you can easily and comfortably do. And therefore, our integral, which I may call as I, reduces to 1 by 2x plus 3 dx plus 1 by x minus 1 dx, since both a and b are 1. And that becomes same as, do we know the integral of 1 by 2x plus 3? Simple, log of modulus 2x plus 3, and don't forget to divide by the coefficient of x, plus log of x minus 1 plus the constant of integration as c. And that's exactly what your integral turns out to be. Simple enough. But you must be very careful, because such questions can easily bring in calculation errors and the things can turn very, very wrong. Now, again, as in all the previous cases, to start with the technique may seem simple, but there could be complications arising because the form may not be always easily directly available to us. Take a look at this. We have 1 by sin x minus sin 2 x. We have been talking about f x by g x, where f x and g x are polynomials in x, and we have brought in trigonometric functions. So, wait, we can turn it into something similar to what we have just discussed. Take a good look at it. I can rewrite this as sin x minus 2 sin x cos x using expression for sin 2 x. And therefore, it further reduces to 1 by sin x into 1 minus 2 cos x. And therefore, it suggests to that we should bring it down to a polynomial, bring using in some substitution. And the substitution here should be such that it works. And here, if you see cos x, if I take as t, I should have minus sin x dx in the numerator, which is absolutely not here. So, what? We can always multiply and divide by that required quantity. So, I can multiply and divide by just sin x. Negative will take care of itself. So, sin square x 1 minus 2 cos x, and this is same as again sin x by 1 minus cos square x into 1 minus 2 cos x. And now, definitely you can't miss the clue. If you take cos x equal to t, the expression reduces to cos x equal to t minus sin x dx is same as dt. And therefore, it reduces to minus dt by 1 minus t square into 1 minus 2t. And that's exactly what we have just discussed. Of course, 1 minus t square is 1 plus t into 1 minus t. So, clear indication that we should use partial fractions. And therefore, we can rewrite it as minus 1 by 1 plus t into 1 minus t into 1 minus 2t equal to a by corresponding to 1 plus t, a by 1 plus t plus b by 1 minus t plus c by 1 minus 2t. If you have been listening attentively and working side by side, you will not find the calculation of ABC any difficulty. So, what I will do is, I will give you the values of ABC, you work it out and check whether you do get that. And how do we do it? I will just include one more step for your convenience, a into 1 minus t, 1 minus 2t plus b into 1 plus t into 1 minus 2t plus c into 1 minus t square. And take suitable values of a, b and c, and you will have a is equal to, turning out to be, taking value of t as minus 1, a will come out to be minus 1 by 6, b will come out to be 1 by 2 and c will come out to be minus 4 by 3. And once you have the values of a, b and c, substitute back here and complete the problem. And don't forget to replace t by cos x in the end, because your function has to be again in the original variable x. I hope you have got the idea. You can take many more such problems and you will be able to reduce them very simply to what we have just discussed. This technique is also very important and it makes the task very easy for us to integrate functions of a very again special type. And the function looks like something like this, 1 by x into x raised to power n plus 1, where n can be any number. Again, it does not give any indication of the partial fraction simply because one does not know whether this n is square or n is 2 or n is 3 or n is 100. And even if we do know, it does not make our task any easy. So, what we can do here is, let us see. What I can do here is multiply both the numerator and denominator by x raised to power n minus 1. And where do we get that clue to multiply it and divide by x raised to power n minus 1? Simply because x raised to power n is the troublesome part. So, if I want to remove x raised to power n, put x raised to power n as t, and what is its derivative? Right, n x raised to power n minus 1. So, that is the clue here. And if I multiply, I get it as x raised to power n into x raised to power n plus 1 dx. And now you can see x raised to power n equal to t. So, x raised to power n minus 1 dx will be equal to 1 by n dt. And your function looks like 1 by n dt by t into t plus 1. And see, we have got the denominator factorized into linear non-repeated factors. Break it up again as partial fractions. Not a very difficult task, and see for yourself the answer turning out to be 1 by n log x raised to power n by x raised to power n plus 1 and of course the constant of integration. You can take these questions, that is 1 by x into x raised to power n plus 1 with n equal to 6 or 5 or 3 yourself and try to see. This technique will always work. The second technique, the second type of where we use the method of partial fractions requires more work. So, be ready for that. We have the second type where we have the denominator factorizing into linear repeated factors. We have 3x plus 1 by x minus 2 whole square into x plus 2. It is already readily available in the linear repeated factors form. So, I will start the work directly. Keeping in mind the table that we showed you, we can write this as a by x minus 2, we are corresponding to the x minus 2 whole square. So, a by x minus 2 plus b by x minus 2 whole square are the partial fractions corresponding to x minus 2 whole square, plus the non-repeated is x plus 2. So, corresponding to that you have c by x plus 2. Again, if I combine the terms here on the right hand side, you can see the numerator turning out to be a into, on taking the LCM, a into x minus 2 into x plus 2 plus b into x plus 2 plus c into x minus 2 whole square. And on the left hand side, the numerator is 3x plus 1. Don't worry about the denominator, because on taking LCM, both are already equal. So, again the task is now to find a, b and c. To start with, you can see that if I take x is equal to, say, positive 2, this gets 0, x minus 2 whole square becomes 0. So, I can find the value of b. X is equal to 2 gives us 7 is equal to 4b, and therefore, b is equal to 7 by 4. Taking x is equal to minus 2 and substituting, you will be able to get minus 5 is equal to c into minus 4 raised to power 2, and that gives you c is equal to minus 5 by 16. Now, if you take a look back at the expression here, there is no value of x for which the values of b and c together, that is the coefficient of b and c simultaneously, becomes 0. And so, we go back to the technique of using the coefficients of the like terms being equal on the two sides to find the value of c. And for that, that is, sorry, the value of a. For that, let's equate the coefficient of x square on both the sides. And here you can see the coefficient of x square is 0. On the right hand side, the coefficient of x square is a plus the coefficient of x square that comes from here as c. And so, you will be able to get 0 is equal to a plus c, which gives you a is equal to minus c, and that is equal to 5 by 16. And so, our integral can be written as integral of 5 by 16 by x minus 2, a is 5 by 16, b is 7 by 4. So, it is 7 by 4 times of 1 by x minus 2 integral, x minus 2 whole square integral plus c. C is minus 5 by 16. So, it is minus 5 by 16 into integral of 1 by x plus 2. Completing the integration, we will be able to get the integral as 5 by 16 log x minus 2 minus 7 by 4, the integral of 1 by x minus 2 whole square, 1 by x minus 2 minus 5 by 16 log x plus 2 and the constant of integration c. You can also see that you can adjust the first and the third term as 5 by 16 log x minus 2 by x plus 2 minus 7 by 4 to x minus 2 plus the constant of integration. And that is the simple solution that you get using the partial fractions. And so, only the calculation of a, b and c takes more time. Otherwise, the task reduces to very simple integrals. The same happens in the situation when the denominator factorizes into either linear and non-repeated quadratic linear factors, or we have linear and repeated quadratic factors. Let's take a look. 1 by x cube plus 1 integral. We all know the factorization for x cube plus 1. So, one can write 1 by x cube plus 1 as 1 by x plus 1 into x square minus x plus 1. And so, when you are breaking it in partial fractions, corresponding to x plus 1, you have a by x plus 1, whereas corresponding to the quadratic non-factorizable form, we can rewrite it as bx plus c, as shown earlier in the table, x square minus x plus 1 in the denominator. And so, again we have to find the values of a, b and c. And that again gets done by equating the numerator on both the sides, for which we have 1 is equal to a times x square minus x plus 1 plus bx plus c into x plus 1. And so, what we have to do is to find the values of a, b and c. To start with, we can easily take x is equal to minus 1 such that this whole term becomes 0, and we have the value of a directly, which comes as, if you take x is equal to minus 1, 1 is equal to, the left hand side is independent of x in this case, but it stays as the given constant in this case 1. So, 1 is equal to a times of 1 plus 1 plus 1. So, that indicates a is equal to 1 by 3. Now, to find the values of b and c, as per the earlier method, this should be reduced to 0, which is simply not possible since it is a non-factorizable quadratic. So, obviously, it does not have any zeros. So, for that we have to go back to our other choice, and that is, to start with, we can equate the coefficient of x square on both the sides. Left hand side, being a constant term, does not have any x square term, and on the right hand side we have a plus b. And therefore, a is equal to minus b, or rather b is equal to minus a. So, b is equal to minus 1 by 3. To find the value of c, you again have a choice. You can equate now the constant terms on both the sides, since everything that gets multiplied with bx will have an x. And so, 1 is equal to a plus c. This implies c is equal to 2 by 3. Substituting, your integral will look like 1 by 3 times x plus 1 plus minus 1 by 3 x plus 2 by 3 by x square minus x plus 1. The first integral is of course simple enough. The second is of the form linear upon quadratic. And that form we had discussed in great detail in the previous lessons. So, you can complete that now and do take more questions on the same line, and you will find the method of partial fractions definitely a very interesting and easier one. Thank you.